about St. Elliot.
Praise the Lord. I just believe that God wants to do something pretty cool. And let me tell you something. It's not by accident that you're here. It's not by accident that this venue is ours. I took Pastor Scotty and some of the guys on a tour of the whole entire building, and they couldn't believe the place that God has put us. So when I say don't miss out on what God wants to do, listen, if you miss out on it, He will call somebody else to do what He needs done. If you don't listen, if you don't hear, if you don't heed the Word and the Holy Spirit, He will call somebody else to do what He needs done. I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it. But I do believe that there's some house cleaning. See, before there's a full release, there sometimes needs to be some house cleaning. Because we have a hard time activating our faith when our house is messed up. insides are messed up, we have a hard time activating our faith. That's why when we're all jacked up, we can't pay our bills, and we're sick all the time, we have a hard time believing that God is really God, and that He really does what He does, and that we really believe what we say. And there's some house cleaning that needs to happen. I believe you're here for a purpose. I believe you're here for a purpose. I want to pray. Sister, I want you to come right here and worship you. See here? Come on over, bro. Come on over, brother. This couple right here, this very young looking couple right here. I don't know them all that well, but what I do know of them is that when I'm in the same building as them, they are always worshiping. And I believe that God is doing something new in both of your lives right now that you have yet to even understand. I believe that God is pouring into you that which you have not yet even understood. And the questions that you have day in and day out, the questions every single night, every single service that you're in, and you don't receive an answer, and you're saying, God, what are we supposed to do? And you don't hear it yet. God, where are we supposed to be? And you're not quite sure yet. Every question in your mind is about to be revealed. If you will open yourself up, clean your house, and say, God, I will have whatever you want. I will submit to the authority you place us in. I will submit to the house you place us in. I will submit to your Holy Spirit speaking in our lives. I want whatever you want, God. And when you release it all to Him, your answers will be here. Your answers will be right in your heart. You will not question anymore. You will not doubt anymore. You will not doubt yourself or everything that you thought was what you were supposed to do. You will see clearly. You will hear attentively. And God will shower you with an anointing that removes the burden that you've taken on yourself. He will empower the people that He surrounds you with. And that is coming right now. Shut up. Church, come on, give God some praise. Come on, give God some praise. Give God some praise. Yeah. It doesn't come by the law. It doesn't come by trying to be super righteous. There is a power that comes when you humble yourself and you bow before the Lord and you come behind His robe and you touch everything He touches. If God passes through this house, you should be touching this house. If God passes through your neighbor's home, you should be inviting yourself to dinner. It's not about accommodating the law. It's not about doing what everybody's telling you to do. It's about humbling yourself, positioning yourself. If you position yourself appropriately, let me tell you something. Lots of people are trying to position themselves. Everybody's trying to position themselves. Everybody's trying to position. But you got to position yourself according to the Word of God and the Holy Spirit that's speaking to your heart. And that positioning doesn't come by trying to follow the next trend or trying to catch the next wave or trying to go to the next trendy conference. And that's not where it comes from. Trust me, that's not where it comes from. I've been to all the conferences. I followed all the waves. I got my surfboard and I rode for a while. But I'm telling you where the power is right here. When you yourself yourself. Hear, feel, taste, see, when you can sense the very presence of the Almighty God, His Holy Spirit coming into this house, when you can sense. You don't need a billboard. You need a sense. And oh my word, oh my word, I feel it, I feel it, I feel it, I feel it, I feel it. I feel it. I feel it. And there's no shame in your game. When you see Pastor Scotty come up with the authority of the Word of God that is in him, you will sense something. You will sense it. And he may not look like your average preacher. He may not look like your average pastor. And that's because he is far from average. And he might be sleeved up, all tatted up, and all different than what you might have expected. But I'm telling you, you got to put your religion aside. And you got to put your senses in motion. You can put your senses in motion. I'm telling you, I'm telling you, I'm telling you. Slap your neighbor and say, I'm telling you. God is going to do something supernatural. God is going to do something supernatural. Can I tell you something? Can I tell you something? Can I tell you something? This lady right here jumping all up and down, all happy on us. She comes from a background of religion. And one day she said, religion aside, God, I just want your Holy Ghost. God, all the law aside, I just want to be happy in you. And there is joy unspeakable and full of His glory when you let Him do that. Come on, you can blow that thing, brother, because I know you're jumping. You want to blow that thing. You just let it release because there is a joy unspeakable and full of
permanently in your
your brain is messed up. God's going to give you a new glow, my friend. He's going to give you a new glow, my brother. I want you to come here. I want you to come here. Listen. You are the way you are because God made you the way He made you. You're built the way you're built because God built you the way He built you. There's a purpose for every single thing. From your birth and even before, He knew you. He knew what He wanted to do with you. He knew how He wanted to shape you. He knew how He wanted to mold you. And everything that you've gone through, good, bad, and ugly, everything you've gone through, God is using to shape you into the man that He wants you to be. In your house, in your community, in your family, and in this church. You're stronger. You're wiser. And God wants to use that. Do not run. Do not hide. Do not make excuses. Because the truth is, as young as you and I are, we are almost out of time. I don't want to run out of time. And when we go to fight the battle, when we go to win the city, when we go to change downtown Salem, I want your hand in mine. I mean that. And you know what? As a pastor, I may blow it. But you know what? We're still brothers. And this is your moment. This is your time. This is the hour. And here's the thing, no matter what is going on in your life, God can change it in an instant. In an instant. In an instant. You say, well, it's going to take some time. No, He can change it in an instant. His Holy Spirit is that powerful. That powerful. He can change it in an instant. Whatever you need changed inside of you, He say, will you let me change it tonight? Will you let me change it tonight? There's no more fighting. No more debating. This is you, God, and a lot of brothers that are surrounding you to help you, to support you, to love you. You and your family. I want you to know, my brother, I will never, ever do anything hurt you. Anything. I love you from the deepest part of my soul. I don't even have to pray right now. But God is doing the work in you. I just want to go affirm it. In front of all these witnesses, I want to affirm that God is truly listening. Whatever you're feeling, you can say, yeah, okay, that was for real. Pastor Kev just called me
here, so I'm just going to tell you now,
if you don't have a place to be tomorrow morning, or you don't have an obligation tomorrow morning, and maybe you just did church hop and you need to hop right in here tomorrow morning, because this is only part of what's going to happen this weekend. Now, I don't want you bailing on your church. If you're an usher there, you need to go, "Ush." Okay? But if you can be here tomorrow morning, you need to be here. Pastor Scotty has come a long way. He's come a long way. He's been in ministry for a while. And this brother, see, this is the thing. He reached over to me because he couldn't come when we invited him the first time. He was going to, and then something happened with his roof, or a tornado hit his house, or something got jacked up and he couldn't be here. So he reached over to me this morning and said, "Hey man, thanks for inviting me again." Him and I are brothers. This is the cool thing. Is that I could go 10 years, 15 years, 20 years and not see him. But the moment he steps into town, I stop what I'm doing and we connect. So he's welcome here anytime. Anytime. And he's got to come back because he already set an appointment with a tattoo place downstairs. So I know he's got to come back. So he's going to come back. I mean, we went down and messed some people up down there. Because they're like, "Where are you guys from? You don't look like you're from around here." "But we're from the church upstairs." "Oh yeah, we drank your God coffee." We call it God coffee. That's what they said. She goes, "Oh yeah, we had your God coffee. We call it God coffee around here." I say, "You keep drinking that God coffee, girl. You keep drinking it. Pastor Scotty's coming back." He's got some books and some CDs and some materials, I believe, that's going to be set up on the table. And I'm happy to say, for those of you who just got here, don't leave without grabbing my first book. It just came out just the other day. It's on the table over here. I had someone come up to me and said they already read the whole thing. It's an easy read. It's pretty simple. It's my first one, all right? It's my first one. So yeah, Pastor Scotty's got it up there. It's all about positioning yourself. Positioning yourself. It's my first one, so I made it really simple, okay? And catch that on the way out. Catch Scotty's stuff on the way out. I'm only doing this right now. You're like, "Man, you're breaking the flow." No, I'm just getting it because I know the flow is going to pick right back up, and I don't want to mess it up later. So here we are. Would you put your hands together? Get ready to receive the man of God. His name is Pastor Scotty Goulet from Covenant Generation in Tucson, Arizona. Come on and give a shout! Amen. Anyone love the Lord tonight with all your heart? Amen. I want to know if anyone loves Jesus tonight with all your heart. Know that you love him with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your soul. I think you would cheer louder for a football game. Come on, somebody. How many of you love the Lord with everything in you? Get a fit watching Kevin and his brother, watching people get prayed for, watching the pastors go up here, lay hands on people, and worship today. Were those guys good today, or what? The worship, man, they had the boogie out. But how about this worship team tonight? Yeah. Well, before I pray and we get started, there's a magazine outside, and it's for free. They did a thing called Ride Arizona, because if I keep blowing, 500,000. The anointed flow when you talk about the biker magazine. And they called me up and did an article and said, "Pastor Scotty," on the front. It goes to every state in America, because Arizona has more riders come through it every spring, summer, and especially our fall. Over 500,000 riders. And they do a thing in the back about churches you can go worship at. So they did an article, and I said, "Are you really going to do like a good article, or are you going to slam religion? Come on, somebody." Because you know, motorcycle people can be a little on the dark side. But they did a great article about our church. That's out there. And I want to give a couple CDs away tonight. How many of you want something for free? Come on, young people, and have this is called The Phenomenal Few. He was with John Rubin, Gospel Gangsters, Cross Movement, Halo Nose, Marlando.
produced stuff, did a great album called The Phenomenal Few. Many will enter, but few will win. Great album. Who wants this tonight for free? You really want it? Okay, I'm going to throw it back this way so it's going to fly like a Chinese star. But remember those hard cases? They hurt, but this one won't hurt. And then it'll produce what's called motivational music. Mine is on, I got three called Faith, Hope, and Love. When you're going, Marlene and his wife have it, this whole churches I go to, you put this in your car on your way to work, or while you're cleaning your house or working in the garage, you will be tapping your toe and shaking your booty for Jesus. Can you do that? You know what I'm talking about. But this is 21 messages on faith set to music, and it will really encourage her. I'm going to go over on this side over here, because y'all don't look convinced over here. I'm going to give Jesus back there. Oh, see, we right over her head. She's like, yay. And then this one I want to give over here, someone, this wonderful lady who cooked our Thomas Mexican holy moment. Did she cook it too? Can you help? Okay, then I'm going to give you this one. This is a great message I did. Probably one of the best Easters our church ever had, because we had over 930 people and 205 children for the first time, breaking 1,000 people. 154 people born again on that day. So that message is a great message. Go out there, get the magazine. There's some, if you like my humor today and tonight, there's some great stuff out there. Atonement, there's a message on atonement. There's a message on the condition of immaturity. It's a two-part series. There's double disc CDs. Everything's only $5. Come on, somebody. And it goes right to mission. Music, everything goes right to missions. And our orphanage that we're building and working on, like you guys, so it doesn't go to me or to our staff. It goes right to mission. So everything, even the double disc CDs with video on it, are only $5. So come on out, help us out, grab one of my cards, hit me up on Facebook. Let's be friends on Facebook. If you don't like Facebook, then just email me. Come on, somebody. Amen. You guys ready? Turn the lights up a little bit, or what do you want to do? You want me up there? I like being down there with the people, though. Okay, I'm submitted.
What you got?
I'm submitted to my pastor friend. I won't rebel. Where the lights can stay dim like this? Okay. I'm with you. Come on, somebody. Put your hands up in the air. Father, I thank you. I thank you. Come on, begin to pray right now in the Holy Spirit. What a conference this has been. Father, we lift our hands. We pray with the Spirit of the living God. Lord, we thank you. We have learned so much from all the speakers. God, from all the pastors. And we worship you in spirit and in truth. God, we look forward to tonight and tomorrow. More, God. There is more for us. Prophesy tonight. Come on, somebody, help me out. Lord, let it be profound. Let it be prolific. Let it be practical. But most of all, God, we know it's either prophetic or it's pathetic. And frankly, we want prophetic. Come on, somebody, help me out. Lord, we want your word again tonight. Lord, bless our family. Someone help me out. Bless our job. How many of you are believing for increase in your life? Come on, somebody, say something. You're believing for that raise, for that new job, education. We believe, God, for increase. Thank you, Lord, that our minds are clear. We thank you, Lord, that our minds are clean. We thank you, Lord, that there's no ink on our brains in Jesus' name. Father, we love you. We honor you. I'm good soil. Someone say, I'm good soil. Someone declare it. I am good dirt. God, I used to be a dirt bag, but now I'm good soil. God, thank you. The word is going to go in deep. Say it with me. The word is going to go in deep. I'm not rocky ground. I'm not stony ground. I'm not stoned anymore. Lord, the birds of the air are not going to steal the seed. Nothing's going to choke out the word. Declare it again with me, because I'm good soil. Put the word in deep. Come on, somebody clap and thank you. Fingers are about to fall off, so give her a good clap. Pastor Kevin, it is an honor to be here with you again, and it's an honor to see my pastor friends and Monty and a new friend from Pastor Casey's, and his brother came to our church, and going to have him down sometime. And Marlando, how many of you love Marlando? Marlando is definitely a brother from another mother. Years and years and years, almost a couple decades. Daryl, right, Pastor Daryl, over the region, the area. What a word today! Come on, somebody, wasn't it awesome? He just walked up there in his sandals and his socks. He stood up there, and it was definitely. I thought Grizzly Adams just walked in. And I mean that with all due respect. He stood there. He opened up his Bible and he turned into another man. I got more than that Holy Ghost, 7 to 10 minutes. And, oh my gosh, thank you so much. And Pastor Kevin, your word was straight up this afternoon. Both of them, the short one and then the longer one. How many of you love your pastor? How about his awesome wife? It was packed today. It was awesome. And some of the people had their own services tonight. Another pastor that I met. But I want to talk. I want you to title this, Excuse Me. I'm not talking about a sneeze. Come on, somebody. But we do say, Excuse Me, when we sneeze. I want everyone to say, Excuse Me, real loud. 1, 2, 3, go.
Excuse me.
I want you to say, Excuse Me, with an attitude. I mean, get an attitude right now for the audience that's watching and for God that's watching. Sometimes you can say, Excuse Me, with an attitude, with a real intensity. Everyone say it with an intensity and an attitude. 1, 2, 3.
Excuse me!
Okay, I think you did a little bit better than that. Just shake the wall. Let every demon and imp in hell know, oh my gosh, something's happening. Get an attitude and say, Excuse me. Go, Excuse me! Say, Excuse me. We say, Excuse me. For those of you that weren't here today, I talked about, and I am tattooed, completely covered, and I can't go over my whole testimony again, but I got saved when I was 16 years old and 4 months, and I told the crowd today I was a hoe. I'm not talking about a ground-moving instrument. But when Jesus fills the... You helped me finish it today. You can say it tonight, huh? To let all the guests and friends that are here tonight. But when Jesus fills the hole in your soul, say it with me.
You ain't a hoe no more.
Come on, somebody. Now, I've said that for years, but Jesus really filled the hole in my soul at 16 years old and 4 months. I'm almost 50 years old. I've been married 30 years. I have 3 full-grown children. I have 5 grandchildren. Come on, somebody. Yeah. Come on, somebody. Just be married 30 years. And it's a big deal to be married 30 years. When I put that image up, they might have it again for tonight so that those that are joining us tonight can sort of feel like on the same page. But I was inked on my brain for many, many years before I got born again. And we talked today about... Be careful being permanently inked on your mind. Paul said to renew your mind, right? Romans 12, 1 and 2. And he said to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. The book of Romans talks about, I'm just sort of bringing everyone on the same page. And we put this image up of a world famous tattoo where the guy literally had his head shaved and inked his head to look like we could all look at his brain everywhere he goes. But I talked about with this image how we get inked on our mind before we ever get a tattoo. The number one tattoo in Hong Kong, you remember what it was today? The number one tattoo in Hong Kong is what?
Loser.
Say it. What's the number one tattoo? What?
Loser.
The number one tattoo in all of Asia is loser. And so I had a world famous artist tell me that people have what's on their mind show up on their bodies way before it's in their mind. It's inked on their brain. And for those of you that are joining us, you know, I was, my mom was married 5 times, 2 live-ins, 7 total men. My dad, my real father, has been married 4 times. He divorced, I didn't say this today, but he divorced his last wife, Beth, and married her older sister, 10-year older sister, Helen. My family is jacked up. And they know that I'm going to talk about them all around the world. Some of them are really mad about it. And others of them are like, if Scotty can share our testimony, that he can touch one young person's life who's been molested and abused or beaten or rejected, or multiple parents and fathers that have left them, and hurts after hurts. I talked about it today, and we prayed together, but I want all of you here tonight to know that God radically changed my life. And it wasn't because I lived in Roswell, New Mexico, where the aliens landed. Come on, somebody. But I got abducted. I got abducted by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit took me up. Come on, somebody. And, you know, alien lovers say they get abducted and they get probed, but I got abducted by the Holy Spirit and probed by the Holy Spirit. I mean, he just radically changed my life. And so I met Jamie at 16 years old. In 4 months, I got born again. I've been in ministry full-time for 30 years, been saved for longer than 30 years. And don't let the tattoos and the biking and the things fool you. Our church, I told them today, is 17 stripper single moms have become born again this year. Come on, somebody give the Lord a hand. These single moms, they're beautiful ladies, and they had to do that. They felt like that they did not know Jesus, but they've given their hearts to Christ. And now they ain't stripping no more. Because if God fills a hole in your soul, you don't dance on a hoe no more. And some of them are watching, you know, and tuning in. They're probably cracking up right now. But we've had over 110 people get free from crack, meth, and cocaine. When you walk in our church, it's not a normal church. We told the pastors today and the crowd today that we pray for God to send the 1 Corinthians 1 type of ministry, the weak, the base, the lowly, the despised, the rejected, the hurt, those that are not, to bring about God's purposes, to confound the very wise. Literally raising people up out of the trash heap, and we pray for them, and then when we come, we've learned in the religious church to be holiness is looking, being able to spot sin quicker than anybody else. Come on, somebody. Holiness has become being able to look down our nose and say, oh, that's sin, and I'm holy. But that's not what holiness is. Come on, give me a big amen right now. So I want to talk about, excuse me, but I also wanted to let all of our friends of Pastor Kevin, who came to join tonight, and Monty, and all the pastors, and everybody who's here, and everybody's going to be here tomorrow, because there are people who have Saturday night services here in Salem that are going to be here tomorrow. Hey, Salem's a cool place. Come on, somebody. Like, this is a very awesome mall.
Yeah.
The Mexican food here was good. Not as good as yours. But the Mexican food is bomb. And this place, and you guys got to believe that you'll knock out these other walls. Come on, somebody. Until God gives you your property to build or whatever, that you just keep taking over offices and window shoppers. Come on, somebody. You realize all service today, window shoppers came to your door all during service, and your ushers are out there talking to them and greeting them. Come on, somebody's like, wow, people would love for window shoppers. Wow, I was out there setting up my book table. There was a dude standing there right watching the screen while I was out there. He was moved. I'm like, pretty cool. Well, he's like, this is awesome. Didn't even know a church was here. Come on, somebody. Come on, give the Lord a prayer. Excuse me. My little granddaughter is 18 months old, and she flat knows how to need her diaper change. She gets that from her dad. He's a big boy. Joe's fighting in the UFC and in the semi-pros. My son-in-law's bigger than life. He's won a couple fights. He's getting ready to go pro. And he just won in Phoenix today the championship for Arizona for grappling and Muay Thai and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. So he was in the Air Force. He was a loader on the C-130s, a master loader, and now he's doing that for the kingdom. But why I'm saying that is he said that he started reaching some UFC fighters named Drew Fickett, 39 professional fights, and then Drew Fickett in Tucson, Arizona, got hooked on drugs and began to drink, and he lost everything. He lost his daughter. He lost everything. And Joe reached him in a gym, led him to Christ. He might be watching. He might not. We can get it to him on CD. But Drew Fickett gave his heart to the Lord at Covenant Generation Church because my son-in-law was ministering to him at a gym. A professional UFC fighter that was a wash-up. You can go hit Drew Fickett, D-R-E-W-F-I-C-K-E-T-T. Professional UFC fighter. He went under the name Knight Rider. He was beating people, and he'd been beat, but he was well-respected, lost everything. Now he got born again. Jesus filled the hole in his soul. Right? He was laying underneath his motorcycle, upside down, nearly dead, inebriated, high. And now he's not. Because how many of you know there's no high like the Most High? Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. There's no drug that can do to you what Jesus can do to you. How many of you know Jesus has wrecked you for normal? Yeah. How many of you in here have been wrecked for normal? Yeah. I'm looking at a bunch of not normal people. Okay, I'm standing over there worshiping with you guys, and this older guy, honored citizen, breaks out a ram's horn during worship, starts blowing it, scared me to death. And I've been in Pentecostal churches. I know what a ram's horn is, but I wasn't expecting it. And he's like, it's like, ooh. I'm like, and I felt it. Y'all aren't normal. Someone say, I'm not normal. Have you noticed I'm not normal? Have you noticed Kevin is a little bit peculiar? Kevin is a little bit peculiar. Different. He's a little bit different. Monty's not normal. Marlando's not normal. Marlando is not a normal dude. If you get around him, he will mess you up. Pastor Darrell, I know if I hung out with you, you would wreck my life. And I look forward to it. I look forward to the relationship in the future. Randy, you're strange. You moved all the way here. You sold out for God. That's not normal. The worship team, y'all are messed up. All you older, honored, I'm getting older too. I'm about to get my discount in my hand. I'm looking forward to it. But I honored them today, the marriages that are 40 and 60 and 50 years long. And I'm looking forward to that. Because a part of this excuse me thing to tie in with what I said today is I didn't think I could stay married for 30 years. I didn't think Jesus loved me like that even in the beginning of it. I didn't think I could make it. I thought I was on the track that I'm for sure going to end up at least eventually in that. But Jamie and I fought those generational curses. Someone say amen right here. Amen. All right, just because your grandpappy did something doesn't mean you have to live under it. Yeah. Right, just because your grandmama's grandmama had breast cancer doesn't mean you have to be.
Right.
Yeah. God still heals today.
Amen.
I said, excuse me, God still heals today. And I didn't think I could stay married, I didn't, but we did, and there were times we had to go to counseling and to work through things, and I didn't think I could raise the kids that we raised who waited until their wedding night to be with their partner. Now, not without speed bumps, not without people who were trying to come after the pastor's kid, not without a real devil out there, come on somebody, a real adversary. We had to sit down with our kids and walk things through with them, but they just lived this deal. And today there were young people in here that talked to me afterwards who got their glow back.
Yeah.
And he said, we're not going to say, oh, are you struggling? This one's struggling with pornography, and this one's struggling with gave up their virginity. We told a young generation today not to let a 2-inch image any longer control their life. I need a big amen. I need everyone to say amen really loud. There were young men and middle-aged men and teenagers came up and said, I will no longer be controlled, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor Scotty, for coming and saying I don't have to have my mind inked by this little phone and the images of pornography and things like that. I need a big glory shout for all that kind of stuff. I mean, I'll be watching my internet, and you can be free, and you can get your glow back. Someone point your hand at the camera back there. Just reach over your head and say, get your glow back! Get your glow back! In Jesus' name! Excuse me. 2 Corinthians 12:19, Marlando. Get your Bible with you. Come up here with me, my brother from another mother. Today we went outside with the band. Come on up here, Marlando. And we were in our socks because... because we do what Pastor says. And Pastor said, y'all, you get yourselves out here. We're going to take a picture with the band. So Marlando and I had our socks on. But we said, yes, sir. We went outside. And I had white socks on. And Marlando had black socks on. So I went out and I said, I have white socks on. And Marlando has black socks on. And we all cracked up. Come on. It was funny. But Marlando, do you have a microphone that Marlando can hold? I want you to read 2 Corinthians 20:19. Because you have the New King James Version, right? And listen to this verse. I know it'll probably... there it is. 2 Corinthians 12:19.
Again, do you think that we excuse ourselves to you? We speak before God in Christ, but we do all things... beloved, for your edification.
Don't you love Pastor Marlando's voice? Come on, somebody. You know, when I go to African American churches, I did not know this, but they have a Rita.
Yeah.
But they always say read Rita, so I thought all their names were Rita. like when Anita Bynum always says read Rita, but that's her mom's name. So I've been in conferences with Anita Bynum. I'm like, man, every African American church I go to, they say read Rita, and all their names were Rita. I was thrilled. Orlando, read Rita. Read it one more time. Everyone read it. Everyone read it out loud with Marlando's awesome voice. Ready? 1, 2, 3, go.
Again, do you think that we excuse ourselves to you? We speak before God in Christ, but we do all things, beloved, for your edification.
Fast and furious because I want to get to prayer with Pastor Kevin, and I told him that I would do really good tonight. Their miracles will happen. 1 Peter 3:15 says we need to give this reason for the hope that dwells within us. There's two ways and two situations. There's two ways to say this. The first way to say excuse me is when we excuse ourselves. Like, I bumped into someone once. More than once, I bumped into someone, I said, excuse me. He sort of reached out and touched their shoulder, excuse me. Shutting the door on, anyone ever shut the door on somebody? Come on, let me see here. You didn't see them, but out of the corner of your eye, you sort of caught the fact that you slammed the door at them, and we say, everyone say, with me, go, excuse me. We say, excuse me, or you didn't hear somebody correctly at the counter, or at the bank, or at church, or someone is speaking to you, and you didn't hear them correctly, and what do we say? Say it, come on, excuse me. You know, I didn't hear you, but we say, excuse me, I didn't hear you. Could you say that again? Have you ever knocked something out of someone's hands? Come on, let me see some hands. You ever knocked at school, knocked the books out of someone's hands, or knocked something out of someone's hands, and then what do we say? Come on, say it with me. Oh, excuse me. Come on, say it with that kind... come on, go. Oh, excuse me. Like, come on, say it like you just knocked everything over and $1 million went on the floor at the bank. Amen? Everyone say it. Oh, excuse me. That's a lot of money. If you're wrong or in the wrong, what do we say? Oh, excuse me, I was wrong. Excuse me, I was wrong. There's two ways to say this. If you sneeze, come on, everyone say it, go. Excuse me, right? And whether someone says, God bless you, we know where that came from or whatever, we say, excuse me. Now, I know we're all adults here. And so, this is funny, but it's the truth. We all say, excuse me. But we lie. When we too. If you know excuse it. You know everyone, excuse me. That was me. Now, we're adults, we're having fun here at Activate, but that's the truth. Okay? So, we say excuse me for many reasons, to say we're sorry, to have fun. And for those of you that don't say excuse me when you do it, we know the dog didn't. Come on, somebody. This is nice. This is a nice way. Everyone say excuse me. Go. Excuse me. Excuse me. Say it again. Excuse me. That's the nice. It's the kind way. You have to realize that you caught an honored, what I call honored citizen or an older person out of the corner of your eye, and you realize that you almost let the door shut on them, and you... You almost break your back to reach back and, grab it. Because it's an honored citizen or someone who's in the military that served. They got the hat on and I'm just going to go out. I will break my neck if I almost shut the door. Because I served in the United States Marine Corps. And I know what it's like. He breaks out so far. And then he barks at me like a Marine. Awesome, and that lady was like, whoop, whoop, tonight I was like, oh, boy. That was awesome. Yeah. Can we have fun in church tonight? Someone touch your neighbor and say, excuse me.
Excuse me.
Someone touch your other neighbor and say, excuse me.
Excuse me.
Now, another way to say excuse me is like this. Someone says something against what you believe. Your values, your core values, your integrity, the core of who you are. Someone says something against the truth that you live and believe. Or someone says something against what the Word of God says, or the holiness that you and I try to live. And Jesus did this. Jesus said, excuse me, in the temple, and he turned over the tables. Jesus had his excuse me, and he turned tables in the temple and blew their minds. Because he knew they were taking these little animals and these pure animals, and they would charge people. And then they would take them back behind the back curtains, and they would bring them back in, not offering them as sacrifices. The money changers weren't just taking money and doing wrong things with money. The wrong that they were doing, history tells us, is they were taking it back behind the curtain, never slaughtering all the animals, bringing them back again, and reselling the animals for profit. So Jesus comes to the temple, and it's not just this easy little thing. Oh, my Father's house is a house of prayer. That Jesus doesn't have enough power to blow fuzz off a peach. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
But the Jesus that you know and I know that we serve was a man's man. When you shook his hand, you knew you were shaking the hand of a man. Come on, somebody. Do you realize he was big? He was muscular. He didn't have long, dark, curly, beautiful blonde, curly Q hair with beautiful blue eyes and a perfect cheekbone structure and hanging up on the cross like a skinny little white boy with a trickle of blood running down his cheek and a little slice like a little rose cut him right here hanging on the... Come on, somebody. That image of Christ in the Catholic Church, and I mean nothing to our Catholic brothers and sisters. We're having a renewal in Tucson through our Catholic brothers and sisters that are getting born again and coming into our church.
Yeah.
But that image of Christ is nothing what he looked like. Josephus tells us he had a big nose and he had short, croppy, curly hair and he was olive-colored skin and very big and muscular. The dude didn't have craftsman tools. Come on, somebody. He didn't have power tools, but he had the power tools from God. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
This guy built furniture and chairs, and you know he rubbed the nail between his thumb and his forefinger, those big old nails, in anticipation of the pain. He knew as he plumb lined and
dovetail things, to build things. He knew that the tree that his father created would be the very thing that he's working on, that he would completely give his life on. Come on, somebody. Could he have known? Yes, he knew. And he said, excuse me, my father's house is a house of prayer. And he started flipping tables. But before Jesus can do anything else in your life, he turns tables in your heart. Yeah. Come on, somebody. Yeah. Jesus flips tables. Yeah. He flipped the table in my life. He flipped tables over inside of my heart when I was 16 years old and 4 months, meeting my wife-to-be, and I didn't know it, but I really liked her, and all that stuff. I had one agenda, and God saved me from all that. Come on, somebody. But he turns tables in your heart. Someone say amen right there. He turned the table. You were in worship. You heard a song. It was a phrase. It was a billboard. It was a preacher. It was a youth camp. It was a junior high camp. It was a vacation Bible school. It was someone told you, and something turned in. Oh, come on, somebody. Something turned over inside of your life. Jesus was saying, excuse me. He has an excuse me with you. He had an excuse me with them. Someone shout, excuse me. Go, 1, 2, 3. Excuse me. My father's house is a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. Matthew 21:13. Mark 11:17. Luke 19:46. You don't need to put it up there. Come on, somebody. That's just so someone gets the verses. It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Jesus had another excuse me on the mountain with the devil. Come on, somebody. He had another excuse me when the devil comes up there and Jesus says, it is written. That was like, excuse me.
Yeah. Come on.
Come on. Well, no, I think out of all the temptations, the last one was extremely insane. He's rejected. His own people don't like him. He's in his ministry and the enemy. He's starting doing stuff and he knows everything because he's God's son. He's God in the flesh. And the enemy tries the other stuff, you know, turn the stone to bread because he was hungry. He's like, excuse me? It is written. Then he takes him up to a high place and says, jump off here, Lord. God's giving you charge over the angels. You're not going to dash your foot against the stone. You'll survive. Excuse me? I think I got a little more intense. Excuse me? It is written. Get behind me. I think his lips were parched. I think he was drained. I think he was thirsty and hungry. And the devil himself says, see all these kingdoms. Now when it got there, I think that was a big deal. I think for whatever reason, scripturally, biblically, theologically, doctrinally, all of this can be proven. I definitely believe that when he showed him, because somehow Lucifer, Slewfoot, that old dragon, the serpent, the devil himself, all of his names, I think somehow he had the power and authority to give Jesus every kingdom. Come on, somebody. Yeah. That is biblical. Yeah. Somehow when he was cast out, Jesus said, I saw Lucifer fall like lightning. Yeah. So this big old Carmen stuff and the songs, 9, 10, 9, 8, the battle of the century in the ring between Jesus and Satan, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and teenagers shouted in Colosseums, he's alive! He's alive! Carmen sang, we're like, woo! I don't think that's how it happened. I think Lucifer said, I will ascend above it. That whole thing that was written in the Old Testament, I will establish my place in the most holy hill. He's I this, I that. He was a I-ite. Come on, somebody. He was a me-ite. And he started saying that, and then God just went zap. And Jesus said, hey, look, I saw him fall like lightning. Come on, somebody. I think Jesus wrote another verse. The song that Carmen is going to sing is not true. Come on, somebody. I'm just having fun because Carmen's song drives me crazy. But but our theology needs to be correct. Boom! Rebellion doesn't last in front of God. Boom! Division doesn't last in front of God. So he had his excuse me many, many times. And that one with the kingdoms, I think, and I need to hurry, but that one with the kingdoms, I think it was like, whoa, hey, that's what I came for. Father, didn't I come for? You know, because it says he was tempted in like manner as we are.
Yeah.
The Bible says he experienced everything we experienced, but knowing no sin.
Right.
So that temptation had to have been a major one. But you know his excuse me was a little bit different than bread and stones being turned to bread. And okay, I could call on legions of angels. I know that. And Satan wants me to jump off this high cliff. And that one was probably like, excuse me? It is written. But the last one was like, you know he had to go, excuse me! So tonight I want to talk to you about getting your excuse me back, because Moses had his excuse me with Pharaoh. Come on, somebody. Right? Come on. Elijah had his excuse me with the prophets of Baal. Esther had her excuse me with the most wicked king on the planet of the day. Do you know who Esther fought? And I don't care whether you like the movie 300, but did anyone see the movie 300? Just fast forward through the oracle. Praise the Lord. We're seen in the movie. But the whole truth of 300 is those guys did stand against the most wicked king on the planet, who thought himself to be a type god on the planet. That is the king of the Bible that Esther faced. It is not the TBN movie, One Night with the King. You see the movie with the good-looking guy with the curly hair and the little thing spinning inside, the little Hebrew thing spinning inside of the lights, and Esther, you know, comes into the king's palace, and the story told by TBN and all those guys and John Hagee and all, they did that story. That was not the king that they faced. The king that they faced was very, very, that she faced was very, very wicked. So Esther had her excuse me with that king. She wasn't called for. Her life could end at that moment. She had been prepared and bathed in ointments and fragrances for 6 months, being prepared for this moment. The Hitler of that day was taking by storm nations. And she knew she had to stand up for her generation. And she said, excuse me, if I die, then I die. That's an excuse me. Wouldn't you say that? Can you imagine standing up in the middle of your high school and saying, excuse me, I'm a Christian. And this is my junior or senior year. Or sophomore, freshman. And if you get within 10 feet of me this school year, I'm going to tell you about the love of Jesus Christ. That's a big excuse me. Come on, Sarah. We need to get our excuse me back.
Come on.
We need to get our excuse me, not the holding of the door. And those are good to have. Excuse me, excuse me, excuse me, sorry. We need to get our excuse me back. I need a big amen right there.
Amen.
Job had his excuse me with his wife and friends. Noah had his excuse me when everyone mocked him about the flood coming and building this boat for years and years and years. Moses, Noah, what are you doing? Building a boat. 40 years later, Moses, Noah, what are you doing? Building a boat. Come on, somebody. Took years. Nehemiah had his excuse me. We got to rebuild this wall because the Ashdodites came in and utterly destroyed God's wall. And Nehemiah said, we're going to get up on this wall. We're going to have a hammer in one hand. We're going to have a sword in the other. Come on, somebody. And we're going to fight and we're going to work. And we're going to fight and we're going to work, because marriage is a fight and marriage is work. Come on, somebody. We're going to worship because we got to worship because we're warriors and we're worshipers. You're going to have to fight for your family and get up on this wall and get a hammer in the morning, pull out the sword, stab the enemy, cut his head off when he tries to get up here while we're working on this wall, while we're working on this church. Come on, somebody, while you're working in this community, you have to stand up and get your excuse me back. Excuse me, President Obama. Ooh, it got quiet in here. I pray for my president every day.
Amen.
I love him in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He's crazy.
Amen.
That's all I'm going to say. It's crazy right now in our nation. And they come here to preach politics. We need to get our excuse me back. Right? I don't think any of our frontline warriors that give you your freedom and me my freedom should make $26,900. $901 shedding their blood for us while our politicians make $275,000 and $350,000. I definitely have opinions that are truth. Come on, somebody. And so you, but God will put the right person in there. God will take care of this tick, yeah.
Amen.
And if not, if it's all got to get messed up, I'm a pan tripper. Because it's all going to pan out. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
I don't know about pre, mid, post, or all millennial reign, but I'm a pan tripper.
Yeah, come on.
It's all going to pan out.
Yeah.
Excuse me, I said it's all going to pan out.
Yeah.
Hey, if God wants to hide me in the rock called Petra, if God wants me to be one of those guys that stick around, I'm cool. I'll come out swinging. Come on, somebody. I don't know that. Some of you are like, hide you in the rock Petra. You can look it up. There'll be some end time prophets that are hidden. Just the way Eden is hidden, the angel's going to cover it. Won't be able to even see them, but they're going to come out in the end time swinging. Preaching the gospel.
Yeah.
It's crazy to think that there's going to be this reign with Christ and their spiritual people who have been translated and have gone on before, and then there's going to be those who have been born on the earth and those that are human beings like normal. I don't understand it all, but I'm excited about it.
Because
there's a big old excuse me coming. There's a big excuse me with the dude who has our names written in his hands. There's a big old excuse me with a dude named Jesus Christ of Nazareth who's got King of Kings and Lord of Lords written in his thigh.
Amen.
There's an army coming that's going to say, excuse me! And the Battle of Armageddon, it's on like Donkey Kong. Come on, somebody. It's on like Donkey Kong. Okay, for all the older ones in here, it's on like Ping Pong. Remember Atari? Those were hard. And then we got Galaga, and we got Pac-Man, and this. But we thought we were moving and grooving. Now you guys have games. It's like, oh my God, I just died. Kids being picked up by the army and the Air Force flying things because they can do that. When I get lost, I crash, I die, I burn. Every time I try to play with my kids, it's like, ah! You put Atari in my hand, I will whip you down. You put Pac-Man or Miss Pac-Man or Galaga in my hand, I will eat you down. And those are things. Excuse me, I will. Moses had it, Elijah had it, Esther had it, Job had it, Noah had it, Daniel had his excuse me to the king when he openly prayed 3 times a day out of his window. When he was told not to, he would open up his window and pray. But guess what? He didn't just do it because the king told him. He just, of his custom. Someone taught him how to pray 3 times a day. He didn't just do it because the king said, if anyone does it, I'm going to mulch up your family and make your family a pile of manure. The decree that went on the poles was, if you do this, I will mulch your family up and make them a dunghill or a pile of manure. And David's like, well, Daniel's like, I'm just going to open up my windows and pray. Come on, somebody. Maybe it sounded like, excuse me!
Come on.
Lord God of heaven! I don't know what it sounded like, but it must have been like, and everybody's like, is that Daniel praying again? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had their excuse me. Oh, come on, somebody. Three classic guys said, O king, be it known that our God can and will deliver us out of the fiery furnace. But if not, he's still God. I love the butts of God. Don't you love the butts of God? Right? Gideon, I love God saying, but arise, you mighty man of valor. And Gideon thought, I'm the least of my tribe. I'm the lowest of my family. I'm the weakest of them all. I'm nothing. I'm a nobody. I am the weakest of my tribe. And the angel says to step right over him. In other words, he was stepping over what he said with his mouth and said, surely God is going to use you. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Surely the Lord is with you. He said, arise, you mighty man of valor. And Gideon got his butt arise. Come on, somebody. I love God's butt because God has a big butt. Come on, somebody. Did you just get offended? God's butt is bigger than my butt. Come on. Literally, God's word for butt is bigger than my butt, God. Oh, come on, somebody. God, I can't. And God said, but arise.
Yeah.
I love the butts of God. I love grammar. Because wherever God puts that, John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But!
Yeah. Yeah, come on.
God came to provide a life. Come on, somebody, and have it for a minute. I love God's butt.
Yeah, come on.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
You know what it took for Daniel to go? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to go? But if not, he's still God. Fiery furnace got lit up. 7 times it slew the guys going to the door, killed them dead. They bound them hand and foot, put them inside. And walking around inside of that fiery furnace, loose, the king looks in. The guy looks in before the king says, "Oh my, someone's got to tell the king." "I'm not telling you. You better tell him because you, someone's in there. I'm not telling. King's going to turn us into poo-poo. If you tell him, you're going to be turned into doo-doo. Doo-doo, poo-poo, caca. You're gone." Talk about, excuse me. They go, "Mr. King, you need to come take a look at this." And what? You know, because he's making all these decrees and posting them on the doorposts and walls. He looks in, he goes, "Were there not 3 bound and tied up? But I look in and I see a 4th man." And the name he calls out in the Old Testament was Jesus' favorite name in the New Testament. That's a revelation all his own. I'm trying to preach it. When he said he appears as to be the Son of Man. Jesus, his favorite name was the Son of Man. And he called him that. They opened up the furnace and here comes 3 classic guys with 3 classic cokes in their hands with a straw and an umbrella. And they came out, not literally, I'm a storyteller. Come on, somebody. And they came out going, "Woo! We didn't bow to your idols. No!" If Jesus was a storyteller, then I'm going to be a storyteller when I tell a story. "We didn't bow, no. No!" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were singing, "We didn't bow to your idol." Heard that old song? "We didn't bow, no. Sequences. It's a technique that's taught. It's called hip upon thigh. In the Hebrew language, it says hip upon thigh in your Bible. So he was like a human guy, but could move with superhuman strength. Because his covenant was in Numbers chapter 6. He took that vow of a Nazarite, put the braid twisted in his hair within the tassels. It was the anointing and the covenant that he made was not in his long hair. It was in the tassel that he portrayed, because Aaron and Moses stepped up and said, if there's any, the man, the priest of God said, if there's any man or woman who wants to vow the vow of a Nazarite, come forward. So though Dr. James Dobson says women not in ministry, in the beginning of it, God says, if any man or woman, come on somebody, desires to bow the vow of a Nazarite, let them come forward. And then that vow of a Nazarite is, no razor shall touch your head. The vow of a Nazarite is no kernel, no husk, no grape, no type of alcohol. Even to the kernel and husk shall cross your throat or your mouth. It's in Numbers chapter 6. And the Aaronic blessing that we hear Jewish people and even churches say, the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine. And churches do that at the end of the church. But the only ones who can receive that inside of a church service are those who have vowed that kind of vow before the Lord, to live a Nazarite type of lifestyle. And then they could shave their head and offer up their hair as that sacrifice and that praise and worship unto God. Then the third one is they could come near no dead flesh. So how did Samson have his excuse me so powerful that he never came near any dead flesh, but he was killing all kinds of Philistines? For whatever the reason, God had a real issue with the Philistines. The Bible says one of his issues was they were uncircumcised dogs. They were uncircumcised, very large, very big human beings. Whatever your theology and doctrine is, I really don't care. Facts are, angels fell, saw the daughters of God. The daughters on the earth, the daughters of men to be pleasing. And this is crazy for kids to understand, so I'm going to be real careful. But basically, giants were created in the land. That's crazy to even think about spiritually like that. But that's the truth. So God despised and came against the Philistine race because of their filthiness, their uncircumcision, and the spiritual side of life. And he raised up a dude and a whole army of dudes and dudettes. Come on, somebody. Chickas. The ladies, come on, someone thank the Lord for the women of God in this building. Come on, thank the Lord. That was quite like crazy against the Philistines. Well, Samson had his, and he fought him all the time. We know he laid his head in Delilah's lap of compromise. We all lay our heads in Delilah's lap of compromise at some time. You all have a Delilah, every one of us, where we lay our head, where we shouldn't. I'm not just talking about sexually or physically, but we all can compromise at times. And he did. And he told her the secret of his covenant and his anointing. And they came and they bound him, they cut off his hair. And there he is, eyes gouged out, pushing in a grind mill, can't see, no vision. And they're up on amphitheater, stadium, second and third level, jeering and threatening and happy that Samson, the guy that killed so many, it's okay that I tell you like this, Samson had so many, killed so many, they're jeering, they're jesting, they're yelling, they're screaming, and then all of a sudden, his hair, says it in your Bible. I don't care what you've been through, because I went through sheer pain, but your hair will grow back. Here's the deal. He's pushing, and they're courting, jesting, jeering, yelling at him, and as he pushed with no vision, he's saying, Lord, one more time, deliver the Philistines into my hands. Oh yeah? Excuse me. Excuse me. And it says, and his hair began to grow back. The minute, right after it says that, the Spirit of the living God came upon him again. He did a big old excuse me. I need a big amen right there. He did a big excuse me in the wall. He pushed the pillars. The place came down. And the Philistines are like, oh no, jerk, you jerk. Hey, I know that's crazy. He kills us all the time. Excuse me. I love it. Someone shout, excuse me. What would you do? What are we going to do? Abraham Lincoln had his excuse me. With slavery, Dr. Martin Luther King had his excuse me. To see black people free. Abraham Lincoln the same way. You need to get your excuse me back, girls, when guys cuss around you and you're a young lady, a young woman of God, and guys in middle school and high school drop the F-bomb all the time. Your friends are cussing. You hear, look at these girls shaking their heads. You hear it all the time. Cuss words, cuss words. You should stand there as a woman of God, a daughter of destiny, and say, excuse me! Oh, come on. You hear a friend in high school telling a dirty racial joke, you should stop, shake your head, cock your leg, put your hand up. If you keep talking like that, I am going to call down fire. No, you don't know what spirit you are to call down fire.
Yeah.
That's what Jesus said, so I got to be careful. But you can at least say, excuse me, stop cussing like that. If they won't hold the door open for you at your age or your age or young ladies, wherever you're at, stand at the mall. Stand at the door. And you just stand there until someone opens the honking door for you. Because you're a daughter of destiny. You need to start believing that you're a daughter of destiny. You need to start believing, even if you have blown it with a guy, or almost blown it, or went halfway there, or almost got there, first base, second base, I don't care where you've been, you need to stand up and say to yourself, excuse me! Because David said to his own soul, oh soul, why are you so downcast? That's when David was saying, excuse me to me. Come on, somebody. David, can you imagine walking around going, excuse me? Excuse me! Imagine walking through your school going, excuse me! Someone would be like, weirdo. Sometimes you gotta tell your own soul, why are you downcast? Why are you depressed? Why are you going through this mind and soul and spirit? What's going on? And David spoke to his soul. You need to stand there. I know the kids are taking notes and some of the adults. We need to get our excuse me back. Jokes, innuendos. Of course, jesting is the worst in the body of Christ. Saying something and winking, Proverbs forbids. Saying something and like you don't really mean it and then go, we're not supposed to do that stuff. We need to get our excuse me back. Someone say, excuse me. Excuse me. We need to get that. We need to get that. Excuse me? Maybe we could do this and realize that we need to get our excuse me when someone invites you to the party, young people.
Come on.
Let's go party. Excuse me. Come on, everybody's doing it. Everybody's doing what? Oh, you haven't had sex yet? Everybody's doing it. It'll make you a man. Excuse me. My dog has sex and it turned into a man yet. Date Rochelle, Marlando, said to them, no. Came into my house, he's 16 years old, he's got the pecs and the tan body, he's got the right jeans, he's got the blue eyes, straight teeth, perfect hair, drove a big pickup truck. He goes to Mike Hayes' church. And he had heard that Pastor Scotty wouldn't let anyone date his daughter. You're never going to get a date with his daughter. He shows up, comes to my house, we sit down. And he says, I want to ask you if I could take your daughter to the school dance and take your daughter on her first date. And I said, no. And I sat down, put my guns down right here. So I'm a card-carrying member. Now I don't even need a card in Arizona. I still have them. And you're all like, oh my God. Don't let that offend you, okay? So, I'm sitting there, and I said, I have one question for you. And if you can answer this question, bro, you can take my daughter on her very first date. He's like, yeah, shoot. Pastor Scotty, tell me what I need to answer. I said, man, you better answer this right, because I'll ask you one question. If you can answer this question, you can take her on her first date. Put my hand on the gun as I ask him the question. I'm just telling you a story. It's a true story. But I said, are you a tither? Because he went to pastor at our church. He went to our church. So are you a tither? He literally leaned back and he goes, what the heck does tithing have to do with whether or not I can take your daughter on her first date? I stood up, put the gun right here.
He was like, no, you didn't.
I said, here's what it has to do with it. The way I see it is if you'll rob from God, you'll rob from me. Needless to say, God didn't let my house and take my daughter on our first date because he was a thief. My daughter was like, my daughter was Miss Dallas at 19. Miss Dallas at 19. Went to the Texas Miss America pageant in Texas, the largest ever, 64 women, and she got right up in the finals, in the top. She won in Arizona, she won Miss Sierra Vista, Miss Tucson, went for Miss Arizona twice, got runner-up. She's beautiful. Guess what her platform was? Purity and abstinence. She was able to minister to girls about purity and abstinence. She never won in Arizona and won Arizona, but that was her platform, and college money, but it was more she wanted to minister. A girl danced, she broke her ankle, she was going to have to not compete. My daughter got all the Christian girls, laid hands on her ankle. That girl danced, finished, placed number 2, and she said this on the microphone, crying. Rochelle prayed for me with all the Christian girls, about 16 girls. God healed my ankle, and this was the first time in my life, she was bawling, that I ever danced for Jesus.
Amen.
We've got to get our excuse me back. Excuse me, you can be healed. Excuse me, I don't have to suffer with that disease. Excuse me, it might smell like cucumbers, but you can be healed in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody. This lady over here goes, you smell like cucumbers. I'm like, Giorgio Armani smelled like cucumbers? She goes, that's okay, cucumbers have healing properties, and God's going to heal people. You smell like a cucumber. I'm like, that's right. I smell like a cucumber. All your worship, I smell like a cucumber, and I can show far. Someone shout, excuse me!
Excuse me!
Get our excuse me back. Someone's gossiping with you. Excuse me! Help me say it. Someone's gossiping with you. You say what?
Excuse me!
Some guy says, hey, have you looked at porn lately? Excuse me! Yeah. No! Do you want teenagers? Do you want to go have sex? No! Just yelling at school. No! Not going to bow to your idols. No! Senator Nissan Medical said, our butts aren't going to go in the air. This hairy air will not go in the air. Come on, somebody. Senator Nissan Medical, you know what the creed was? When they played the music, bow down. Put your butts in the air. And there are too many butts in the air. Come on, somebody. There are too many older Christians and younger Christians that are bowing down to things that they shouldn't bow down to. And it's time that we stand up and say, excuse me! You want to steal? Come on, let's go steal something. Excuse me! You got to have sex before. You got to try it before you buy it. That's your generation right now. Try it before you buy it. Live together. Your generation also, all these young people here have friends that their door swings both ways. Look at me, young people. Don't you all have friends where their door swings both ways? Come on, help me out. Say something out loud with your mouth. Don't you know friends that are bisexual? They like both sexes. It's everywhere. And you need to be able to say, when they're like, you know, how about you? Which way does your door swing? Excuse me! Door swings one way. Come on, somebody! Get your excuse me back. And I'm not talking about the little excuse me. Oh, sorry I knocked your books out of your hand. Excuse me, I tooted. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Excuse me. When someone say bless me, please. I'm not talking about those excuse me's are awesome. But it's time for us to say, you know, I was at a bike event and my wife was right over here and all my guys, because we're invited to hardcore biker events, they all carry, and they're going to protect their pastor. We have 19 pararescue, that's Special Force Air Force. 41 based in Tucson, 19 have gotten born again, they come to our church. 300 in the world. They're like Navy SEALs, but for the Air Force. They teach the Navy SEALs how to skydive at night in the suits through the sky, going real fast. They're in our church. And so three of them were protecting me and our girls at the booth, and they dress modest, but they dress, you know, biker, you know, cool patches, vests, and our vests say stuff like, these are my church clothes. Come on, somebody. Our vests. And for those of them who aren't here today, I have Hell's Angels that come to my church, Devil's Disciples, Huns, I have loners, I have five different biker gangs that come to my church, they call me pastor. I showed the guys the picture today of the 10 devil disciples who just got born again, now they're Jesus' disciples. Come on, somebody. Taking their best off and giving their lives to Christ. So I'm out there and the Budweiser girls are out there wearing barely any clothes. And one of them walks right up to me, didn't realize that my guys were around me, and began to hit on me. And I laughed at her. I was laughing. And she goes, what? Because she just told me, you know, what she wanted to do. And I'm like, I pointed over there at my wife. I said, have you seen my secretary? Because I told the church today I'm sleeping with my secretary for 30 years. Come on, somebody. Daryl, you were here. I told you, we were cracking up today. I'm still 30 years later, I'm sleeping with my secretary. She's right there. She's my wife. So my church never has to worry about me doing that because I'm sleeping with her already. Come on, somebody! I said, that's my wife right there. And she goes, oh, my wife is beautiful. And I'm like, I'm looking up and saying, why? I looked up, she was crying. And she said, your wife's a very lucky woman. About that time, my wife comes over. My daughter comes over because she saw what was happening. We end up ministering to this Budweiser girl, scantily dressed, who is broken because she's never had a guy turn her down. And really inside of me, I was going, excuse me! Look at my wife! Fake surgery, everything going on. Beautiful to what most men would look with their eyes. I laughed at her. And my wife comes over, what's going on? I said, this girl right here just moved because she never had a guy turn her down. My wife said, turn her down for what? And I said, my guys were like, Pastor Jamie. And we ministered to that girl. Pray for her. You got to get your excuse me back. I was in the bank with my administrator. Marlano's heard this story. And this woman, a teller, beautiful woman. And I don't think, I'm a red-faced looking dude. Like, I look like Santa Claus, is skinnier. I don't know. You know, I just... But and she came. She was a teller that I'd seen there many times, and I knew she'd been divorced four times. And she came over, and she didn't know that Ken, our administrator of the church, were making the deposit. And she gets right up next to my ear, and she says, "What she wanted to do with me in her hot tub." And I was like, I got to be honest. At first, my flesh was like, "Good God!" In the hot tub. I didn't do that, but in my flesh, I was going, "Good God!" Because you think, like, in our flesh, guys, you think, oh, I still got it. Well, I know Megan have heard this in the set, but in my flesh, I didn't do that. That would be weird in line of my, good God, what? My flesh, I thought that. What? What? But instantly, I took my wedding band off. It's my gold one. It's our first one. I just got this one because it's so old. It's 30 years old. I had to take that one off. It's about to break. It needs to be redone. So I took then my gold original wedding band, and I just, at first it was, good God, I'm hot tub. And then my spirit was like, nah, nah, nah. I took my ring off, and I stuck it up on her nose like this. And I went, this, real loud, this means more to me than fleeting moments with you. Come on, somebody. And she began to cry, and Ken and I ministered to her, and I told her, I know you've been divorced four times, and good God in the hot tub, but man, I had to stick my ring on your nose and put a ring on your nose. She was like this. The point is, you you've got to get your excuse me back on. Someone touch your neighbor and say, excuse me.
Excuse me.
Someone say it again. When you're tempted to lie, you've got to say, excuse me. When someone's putting someone down, you need to stand up for them. When someone is picking on somebody, you need to say, excuse me. So we're at another bike event, and this hardcore biker grabbed one of our girls in the butt. I saw it. I ran 14 feet, grabbed him, put him up against the side of a wall. I wanted to react like Christ. My guys had to come grab me, put him up against the... You ever touch one of the girls in my church like that again, you'll go meet Jesus or the devil. The dude's like, aren't you a pastor? This isn't actions of a pastor. Then hardcore biker guys came over and said, put him down, Pastor Scotty. And I said, now you're going to the desert. Now you're going to the desert. Shallow graves and coyotes. And they said, if you ever touch anyone from Generations Church again, you will have issues with us. I was like, wow. But the pastor put the guy up against the wall, arm barred him, and put my arm up under him. I was like, Lord, forgive me, please, Lord, forgive me. Lord, I repent. Now, we're all Christians here. I was just protecting one of the sheep. Jesus said, protect the sheep. I was like, yes, sir. But I'm just saying, I got my excuse me. It might not have been the right response, but I don't think that big guy was going to respond to, excuse me. Could you please not touch one of our God girls? She's a daughter of God. Can you hear me now? How was I going to respond to that? Long story short, came to our church to figure out what all this is about. Long story short, came to our church, loves our church, drives up on his bike. Bikes line up all service for both services. And we have cops. That's weird, huh? 160 motorcyclists, hardcore bikers and bikers, and cops. How many cops? 22 cops in our church. How many sheriffs? 15 sheriffs in our church. Cops and sheriffs, all carrying guns. That's right. Some of you are watching. Crazy. Our kids are well protected at our church. Come on, everybody, for the ones watching, everyone say, excuse me!
Excuse me!
With an attitude, go,
excuse me!
Devil tells you you can't preach, excuse me. Devil tells you you can't be a missionary, excuse me. Devil tells you you can't stay pure all the way to your wedding night, excuse me. Devil tells you you can't start a church, excuse me. Devil tells you you can't go to college, excuse me. The enemy tells you there's no money for you, America is bankrupt, you can't fulfill your dream, excuse me. Anything you set your mind to.
Amen.
You can do anything God
Amen.
Tells you to do. The enemy tells you you're not pure. Excuse me, Jesus made me pure. The enemy tells you that you can't amount to nothing. You say, excuse me, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The enemy tells you if you're not a Christian, start stepping back when the enemy says you're not healed and saying, thank you, devil, for blessing me. You know the devil will bless you every day. You're not healed. Woo! I must be healed because you're the father of lies. Neither would you tell me the truth. Come on, somebody. Start twisting it on that guy. You're not a real Christian. Woo! Excuse me. Thank you, devil, for blessing me because I must be a real Christian or you wouldn't be telling me that I'm not. Come on, somebody. You're not a worshiper. Excuse me. Thank you, devil, for blessing me because I know I'm a worshiper. You don't understand the Bible. The Bible's not real. It's not for today. Excuse me. Thank you, devil, for blessing me, because I love the Word of God.
Yeah. Come on.
some reverse psychology on the devil. Keep them under your feet. How have you allowed him to get up around your ear, whispering to your ear? Silence the voices that influence a generation's choices. The same voices that said, we're too weak, we're too small, we're grasshoppers in our own sight. The walls are too thick. I saw the sons of Anak there. I saw the giant. The walls are too fortified. We can't do it. And Joshua and Caleb rent their clothes and said, excuse me, we are well able.
Yeah.
Who told you you were small? Who told me that I was small? Who told you that you can't do stuff? The same voices that have been influencing a generation's choices for years and years and years. It's time for you to stand up and say, I will not let the enemy silence my voice. I'm going to silence his voice because I'm going to make the right choice. Come on, somebody stand up to your feet. I hope I did okay. One of the worship guys, come up here and play for a second. Maybe if someone had their, or ladies, I said worship guys, come on, there's a lady jumped up. I didn't mean that like a guy has to come. She just said, excuse me, I'm going to play this. She might have called for a guy, but I'm going to go up there. Excuse me. Do you love the Lord tonight? Get your passion back. Pastor Kevin wanted to talk about igniting your faith and activating your faith. And I think it's time for us to get that excuse me back. Maybe, in closing, maybe if someone would have had their excuse me, the extermination of the Jews by Hitler would have been stopped. Maybe if someone had their excuse me, and most of the younger generation parents, they're even teaching in school, in some schools, that it didn't happen like that. But I walked through the Holocaust Museum in Washington. I got 29 feet into the building, and I fell to my knees. I knew it was true, but I saw the pictures and the stacked bodies and the bones stacked, and I thought, oh my God, I knew it was real. And I think these teachers need to shut their mouths.
Yeah, come on.
And people need to understand that maybe, Pastor Darrow, I said a minute ago, that maybe if someone, because I want you to hear this, maybe if someone would have got their excuse me back, then the Hitler who had tried to exterminate the Jews would have been stopped. What about this one? In our just above my generation, maybe if someone had their excuse me, Seth, maybe Madame O'Hara would not have taken prayer out of schools. Prayer got taken out of schools because parents didn't have their excuse me of that generation. Ten Commandments were on the walls of my school. And all you older honor folks, remember, we didn't just pledge allegiance to the flag. We didn't have a president that we still don't know where he's from. That America is different now. The America back then, when I could drink a knee-high and dip a dipping stick in different flavors and lick it and wear my tube socks and be down the street in short gym shorts until 9 o'clock at night till my grandfather whistled. That America doesn't exist anymore. Because that America got molested. And we need to get our excuse me back. No woman should be beaten and abused verbally, physically, or sexually beat down. You need to get your excuse me back. But maybe if we had parents, our kids would still be experiencing prayer in school. But there are kids that pray in school and not just you at the pole because they've got their excuse me back. And I'm not going to meet you on September 18th only. I'll be at my pole every week or I'll start a Bible study because you have pole. You have pole. Access to your school. If there's a French club, you can have a Bible club. If there's a Spanish club or a chess club, you can have a Bible club. If there is a ski club, choir club, band club, one club in your school, you can meet and share the gospel. Not just in an organized classroom where a teacher sponsors you, but during the law reads, not in structural school time. So when your teacher shuts her book, and the class is done being taught, and there's 7 minutes on the deal before the bell rings, you can stand up, open your Bible and begin to proclaim the love of Jesus. Oh, they might take you to the office, but that's called non-instructional school time. Maybe your generation can stand up with their excuse me back. And how about this one? Maybe if people would get their excuse me back, we could stop the genocide of millions of abortions annually. Maybe if we got our excuse me back, we could stop the sheer genocide. Like in Africa, I go there in places where they're still killing human beings. We have a Christianity over here in America where we don't even understand martyrdom. But Christians die every day around the planet for standing up for Christ and what they believe. They are shunned every day inside of families. Even watching TBN in other nations, they are shunned, turned upon, and their lives are threatened. But we in America, our hearts aren't broken. Seth has been there. You go to the Philippines, you go to Indonesia, Thailand, you go to Bangkok, China, you go to China, anywhere. You go anywhere to Indonesia or nations where the church is worshiping underground. And they cry out to God and they worship like we've never worshiped. They got their excuse me, don't they? Excuse me, I'm a Christian. And I'm going to worship my God. Maybe if we get our excuse me back, we could change things. I want to know if anyone wants their excuse me back. Hold up your hand right now. Say something with your mouth. Come on, do you want your excuse me? Do you want that kind of authority? You won't get the anointing of God without an excuse me. All of God's disciples had an excuse me. Fine! Kill me! One lost his head. One was crucified upside down. Several were shot with arrows, with tar on the end, lit with fire into their bodies, and burned and killed. The disciples all lost their lives, and one was exiled to a ravenous island. They tried to cook him first, but they couldn't boil him, so they put him on an island because God wasn't done with him yet. And for a long time, many became followers of John because the guy who called down thunder now was preaching love and grace. And the love that he taught about, many followed him because Jesus said his eyes, his life wouldn't be snuffed out. He wouldn't die before you'll see the coming of the king. So many were watching John to see, oh my gosh, you know, Jesus is going to come back. And when he died, they were tripped out. But God had to write the book of Revelations. And his eyes didn't go dim before he saw the king. Come on, somebody. God wants you. I want everybody from size older, honor, and younger. Come on down here right now. Get all the way for all the pastors. This is the last night of our event of pastors and all the pastors here. Just come on. Out of your seats with your spouse. If you're hurting, if your back's hurting, it's cool. You can hang out there, but join in with us. Come on, press in. Press in, press in, press in. If you're watching by internet, and we know that you are, just reach out right where you're at and say, excuse me with your life. I want this. I want Jesus. Maybe this week someone said you'll take your Bible. And they say, is that a Bible? Do you have a Bible at school? I've not seen it. Is that really a Bible you have open? Say, yes, it is. Say, really? You brought your Bible to school? That's a Bible? Yes, it is. You want to hear me pray in tongues too? Come on, somebody. Someone's got boogers and green stuff and their chest is stopped up at school. Walk over to them and say, can I pray for you? What do you need to pray for me for? That. Get your excuse me back. Excuse me? God heals people. Grab their hands and pray for them. Tell God to dry up their boogers in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody. If someone's got a fever. Did you know, y'all remember Beavis and Butthead? I was in Albuquerque, New Mexico when those writers of Beavis and Butthead, two young men, began to write. They were at Highland High School, just like their movie. They were at Highland High School, and me and Dave Beville, I had 900 students in a four-square church in Albuquerque. Dave Beville had 1,500 students at Victory Love Fellowship, Rob Carmen, who is now over missions for CFNI, Christ for the Nations. A good friend of mine took over that church, but in that day, we were having 1,500, 900 kids come together. They started a Bible club at Highland High School. In this Bible club, these two boys were so mad, the writers, the two kids, the two characters, the writers of Beavis and Butthead were so mad about a healing that happened. You see their shows where they're mocking God and they're mocking Jesus. That Beavis and Butthead could really get after that. all that stuff, and everybody loved the show. I didn't, because I was there. And here's what happened. This kid was in a wheelchair, and he had to drive the wheelchair by blowing. And he slobbered in a thing that caught his drool. He was a very intelligent young man, and everyone knew him. And he would go from class to class to class. Well, this Bible study, this Bible club grew from 50 to 100 to 150 to 200 to 1,000 kids were coming. Blaine Martell, Lee Wilson, major people, Ron Luce, all the guys knew about what Dave B. Hill and Scotty Gurley were doing at Highland, what God was doing at Highland High School. But God was using us and using our kids, and it grew to over 1,000 young people in the school. Then it was 1,500. And this kid, two kids, got so excited about God heals for today. They ran over to this kid while Bible study was happening. They laid their hands on this young man. He got up out of that wheelchair, never walked a day in his life. They watched the boom strengthen in his legs and his arms. It's documented. It's all true. This kid stood up, not slobbering, began to praise God and cry out. Ah! You would thought he was still retarded and struggling, but he got his glow back. Come on, somebody. Ah! He was crying. The principal began to weep. The principal got saved. Teachers began to weep. There was revival at Highland High School, and these kids, within 30 days, initiated that whole program, and MTV picked up on it. And you want to know what? That's exactly how the enemy works. But I don't care, because there are thousands of kids from those 2 years after that who got their lives changed and were saved at Highland High School. No matter what Beavis and Butthead said, no matter what the guys who created it say, there was a move of God on that campus. I have the whole series of Beavis and Butthead, every video, because sometimes I'll pull it out, all the religious ones that they did, and I just sit there and praise God and thank God for the thousands of young people's lives who were changed in 2 years at Highland High School. What would happen if you get your excuse me back? That kid began to preach about Jesus. That kid began to do things for Jesus in the community of Albuquerque, New Mexico. Unbelievable. Amazing, actually. I don't like saying unbelievable, because it's supposed to be believable, right? I had a pastor friend tell me, don't say unbelievable, it's not correct. You went to Bible class, don't say unbelievable. It is believable. Because all things are possible, amen. Except see, I'm trying to correct my soul when I say something like that. What can God do with you? As we pray right now, Pastor Kevin will come and tell us what to do. I'm looking at an army of young people and adults who really believe, excuse me, I believe this Bible. I believe God's word is true. There's a King of kings and a Lord of lords. His name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. He's the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He which was and is to come. He's the wonderful counselor. He's the lily of the valley. He's the bright morning star. Come on, somebody. He's the shining one. He's the lion of the tribe of Judah. He's your God and he's your Savior. Don't you let anyone make you back down. Don't let anyone who thinks they can call you out, you stand up and say, excuse me, I am a fire breathing, devil stomping, world changing, wild, radical kind of Christian. I am a, say it with me, I am a fire breathing, devil stomping, world changing, say wild, wild kind of Christian, say it. Kind of Christian. Say it with me. I am a fire breather. I am a fire breather. Now stop. Devil stop. World change. World change. Say wild. Wild. Kind of Christian. And anything less than that is not what God has for us. Amen? Amen? Come on, lift up your hand. Pastor Kevin, come up here. Father, hear our excuse me tonight. Hear our passion. See our fire. Sense our decisions. Hear our hearts tonight. At Refuge, we activate. Our mouths will speak. Our ears will hear. God, anoint my right great thumb. Anoint their right great thumb to touch only the things that God would trust. Have them to touch. May we be like the priests of God. Anoint their right earlobe. Just touch your right earlobe real quick. Touch your right earlobe and then grab your own right thumb. Grab your own right thumb. Come on, touch your right thumb. And say, God. Say it out loud. God.
I will touch.
Only the things.
That
you want these hands to touch.
You want these hands
this is biblical. Touch your right ear. Your right earlobe. Say, God. I want to hear.
I want to hear.
Only what you want me to hear.
Only what you want me to hear.
I want to receive.
I want to receive.
What you want me to receive.
What you want me to receive.
I want to hear your spirit.
I want to hear your spirit.
And respond correctly.
And respond correctly.
Woo! Now do this. I know it's weird. Grab your right toe. Or touch your right toe. I know you didn't know we were going to Richard Simmons today. Okay. Okay, put your foot down and just say, stretch your hands towards your feet and say, God,
God,
I will only walk,
I will only walk
where you will have me to walk.
Where you have me to walk.
Just like the priest.
Like
just like the prophets.
Like the prophets.
I will touch,
I will touch,
hear,
hear,
walk. Say it again.
Walk.
Touch,
touch,
hear, walk. Say it again. Touch,
hear,
walk. Only where you'll have me walk, where you'll have me touch, where you'll have me hear. Now lift up your hands. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Be that high priest in your home. Be that high priest as a youth pastor. Be that prophetic voice. Be that prophetess. Be that prophet. Be that priest. Be that king. Father, I speak over them. They are crazy people who are going to choose to live a separated life, a Nazarite kind of life. God, that they will live for you and declare to a nation and a region and a city that needs some people who will say it with me, excuse me, go, excuse me, say it real loud, excuse me, I love Jesus,
I love Jesus,
excuse me,
excuse me.
I worship Jesus.
I worship Jesus.
Excuse me.
Excuse me.
I live
for the King of Kings.
Somebody clap. Somebody shout.
I don't know about you, but I've just got a different mindset when I go out into the world. When I leave this place and I go out those doors and I go out into that street, I have a different mindset. We should have a different mind. The Bible says to renew our mind. Our mind should be renewed right now. And when we leave this place, we say, excuse me. Excuse me. Today was the first day I've ever had to actually honk my horn on purpose. And you can ask my wife. I'm not a horn honker. I hate it. Every once in a while, my wife goes into this thing, this mode. And if anybody aggravates at all, and I'm driving, and I don't honk the horn, she'll honk it for me. Today on our way to church this evening, we're driving. I got about six people in the car, and we're on the bridge. And I seen this trucker on the other side of the bridge. He starts moving over. I saw him coming over. I'm like, wow, he's coming over. There's a lot of traffic. Big semi, big trailer, 52-footer, the whole works, 54-footer. He comes over, and I'm like, is he coming all the way over? Now, I'm in my excursion. Now, the excursion is normally I win these things. Okay? But this guy was driving his semi. He starts coming into our lane. There's just a big semi on one side and a wall on the other side and a river 30 feet below. Everybody in the car saw it coming. I didn't panic, but as much as I hate laying on the horn, I mean, you know what? My wife will tell you this is the truth. We could be at a red light. It turns green. You're in front of me. You don't move. I wait. It could be 20 seconds. I wait. 45 seconds later, I wait. I see the light turn yellow. I wait. I will not honk. My wife is like, will you? I'm like, baby, it's cool. We got time. I don't like honking my horn, but today I had to say, excuse me, otherwise we would have been dead. We would have been over the rail, we would have been in the river 30 feet below. You would not have seen me tonight, nor the six other people in the vehicle. Every once in a while you just got to say, excuse me, because if you don't, it's not just you being an intimidated Christian. Lives are at stake. Lives are at stake. And at this moment, I had to say, excuse me, or our lives would have been compromised. Every time we go out these doors, and you have to lay on the horn, you lay on the horn and you say,
excuse me!
Say,
excuse me!
Because it's not time. I love my youth pastor. You know why? Because the other day we had a little powwow. Well, we have these every once in a while. We're in my car and we have a little powwow because I was telling his wife, you know, it's impossible for me to go to Costco, for me to go to Lowe's without him. It's like that's something we do together. It's been a tradition forever. And anytime we need something at the church, we go pick. It could be a screw. It's like, come on, Randy, we got to go get a screw. And so we're in the car. We have a little powwow. You know what he tells me? And I can tell he was serious. He's passionate. I mean, tears almost coming up in his eyes. He says, you know what? I'm just tired of playing church. I'm tired of the church just messing around. I'm not here to play games. I'm here to knock the devil out. And he's tired of playing games. That means every time we go out the doors and someone messes with your ministry, someone messes with your family, someone messes with your mind, you say,
excuse me.
Because we're not playing church anymore. Lives are at stake.
Yeah.
If you're a minister, if you're a pastor, if you're a leader in your church, you best be saying, excuse me. Because I'm telling you, if I was a member and I was going to your church and you didn't have the guts to stand up and say, excuse me, I'd be going to a different church. That's just me. If you're just a layperson in this church, or in this body right here, this building right here, and your pastor doesn't have the guts to stand up and say, excuse me, when people are coming against you and the church, then you go find a different church. And I'm saying that today because this conference, and listen, I know I'm taking a risk because I know I got many other leaders present here. I got other churches present here. Now if they all exit, I'll be like, Pastor, why you say that, man? Because you need to stand up and say, excuse me. We could have said nothing when everybody said, there's no way you can set up a church in this old 143-year-old building. First of all, they're not going to let you. And second of all, it's too expensive. And third of all, it's downtown. Fourth of all, you're spread out. If I would have said that, where would we be today? But no. Randy and I sat in the office right over there. We said, excuse me? No, we can have this building. Yeah. And we will have this building.
Yeah.
Randy was with me. You know when we said, excuse me? On the golf course. I said, bro, on the way home, I still had my golf shoes on. I said, let's stop at that theater, see if we can take that over.
Come on.
I still had my golf shoes on. We walked in here with my golf shoes on.
Boss.
And the owner of the theater was in the building, just happened to be here. I said, listen, the world is saying we can't have this place. But I said, excuse me, hey, man, what would it take? He says, you know what? 2 weeks ago, my wife said, why don't we have a church in this theater?
Come on.
He said that. Less than 30 days later, my church moved from Hauk Middle School into the theater because we said, excuse me? Yes, we can have this place. Yes, we will take over downtown. Yes, we will make a difference in our city. Yes, we will reach the lost. Yes, we will talk to the homeless. Yes, we will talk to the broken. Yes, we will talk to those that are just eating around. Yes, yes, yes. Excuse me? Every single one of you need to hear the words of Pastor Scott and not let the devil kick you around anymore. You just look at him and you say, excuse me? Devil, you are under my feet. You are under my feet. How many of you are going to say, excuse me? Yeah, I'm going to say, excuse me? And when you have the guts and you have the strength to say, excuse me, one more time, you will see the power of God. I think, you know what, we're going to get out of here, but I want the rest of my worship team to come on up. Let's get out of here with a praise in our heart and a shout in our lips. I want to tell you one last story, if you let me. Stay right here, because after this video, let me just tell you this, because I might forget. You know, we're going to take an offering after this, okay? We're going to take an offering. I know if I would have forgotten, the staff would be like, excuse me. I know. So we're going to take an offering out of this, so don't bolt out. We're going to go out worshiping, and ushers, get ready. I'm going to tell you one last story. I was in high school. I won't tell you when, but it was closer to when Scotty was in high school than some of y'all in here, okay? And back then, Ouija boards were really popular. Back then, Ouija boards were really like going all over the place. I go into my high school choir room. And did anybody have a high school choir room with the library? You know, with all the music and the instruments, there's a library, a big hall. They call me in there, and they're in a circle in the choir room playing with a Ouija board. Okay, check this out. I go, excuse me? Okay, I didn't say that back then, but tonight I'm saying it because of the message and all. I said, excuse me? I go, you guys need to get rid of that thing. They said, no, man, it's cool. Check it out. I go, no. You guys need to get rid of that thing. It will mess you up. The next day, Kevin, check this out. I said, no, man, you need to get... I said, excuse me? Uh-uh. So the girl, finally, the girl that was bringing it every single day, she gets messed up in the head to the point where even her eyes were bugging out. I looked at that girl and I said, I'm telling you, if you don't get rid of this Ouija board, you will die. It will kill you. She starts to cry. I didn't even have to preach. She just starts crying. I'm in high school at the time. So she starts crying. I said, I'm going to get rid of it. I know it's going to mess you up. And it's already messed me up. I said, get rid of it. So that day she got rid of it. 3 weeks later, we're on a band or a concert tour. We're going to do a concert. We stop at a McDonald's. I'm on the bus. We're getting ready to leave. These kids, these teenagers, my age, come running out of McDonald's. Kevin! I'm like, what is going on? I'm not even in ministry yet. Kevin! I go, what's going on? You gotta come out here. She's messed up. She brought the Ouija board. I'm like, what? Excuse me? They're in the middle of a McDonald's parking lot playing with the Ouija board. I go, what are you doing? She goes, I know, I should have done it. We're trying to burn it. We're trying to get rid of it forever. They took a lighter and tried to light it, and it wouldn't catch. They tried to burn the whole thing. It wouldn't light. And in other words, as the message said today, I said, you need to get your excuse me back, and you need to declare authority over this. So they asked, what are you doing? I go, heck yeah. We're getting rid of this right now. Give me that lighter. In the middle of a McDonald's parking lot, I looked at all of these teenagers that were messed up because of a Ouija board, and I said, in the name of Jesus, you say it. They said, in the name of Jesus. I said, say it louder. In the middle of a McDonald's parking lot, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, you're going to excuse yourself, and you're going to get rid of this thing, and in the name of Jesus, we'll never see it again. We put that thing under there, and it literally was this fast. Flame, smoke, gone. Nothing. Not any trace. Just gone. Every single one of those teenagers started bawling in the parking lot. Why? Because I said, excuse me? We don't mess with that. They, each one of them, gave their heart to the Lord. Every single one of them. Some of those teenagers in that high school that were messing with that are still my friends today. I still Facebook them. We still talk. Still my friends today. Guess what? In my band, this guy that played the trombone, he was messing with this stuff. To just this last, let's see, the end of July, he calls me on the phone. I haven't even talked to him in years, since high school, 20 years or more. And he called me on the phone. He says, Pastor Kevin, he follows our church and follows everything online. He says, I think I'm called to the ministry. He was in the parking lot that day. We were in L.A. He wanted to come see us in L.A. I didn't even tell my wife that story, but he's one of them. We were in L.A. He tried to drive to L.A. where we were so that he could just talk with us and tell that he's going into ministry now. You have to say, excuse me? Because lives are at stake. Amen? Amen? Excuse me. Let's sing. We're going to go out with worship. We're going to go out with praise. Ushers, if you'll come right here up front, what I want to do, listen folks, I know that you're being blessed. I know that you're being touched. I know that God is moving and He is sovereign. He will always move. But here's what I want you to do. Tonight, I want you to listen to the Holy Spirit as we go into worship. And as you're worshiping, before we leave this place, I want you to come to the altar and I want you to say in your mind, excuse me? Excuse me? I will not fear. I will not be swayed. I will go with God. Excuse me? And if you will get your excuse me back, I believe God will bless you for that. Amen? Come on, let's worship the Lord. Anytime as we're singing, I want you to come and say, excuse me, bring your offering. Let's bless the man of God. Come on. Come on, let's do it. Come on. Bring your worship and giving. Sing this with us.
In the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain. Break every chain. To break every chain. Yeah. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Conference will be well taken care of. Come on, let's pray. Father God, thank you for obedient men of God, obedient women of God. Lord, thank you for the ministries you have given us relationship with. Father, I thank you, Father, that they are obedient to your word and your Holy Spirit. And I pray right now that you would multiply the gift and that you would bless both the gift and the giver. For those who have not to give today, Lord, I pray that they would have a testimony going out, knowing that they are blessed. And that they will say, excuse me. And Father, Lord, that we would give you all glory, all honor, and praise, Father, because you are worthy of it all. Lord, we love you. Thank you, Lord. for your provision and your power in this place tonight. We go away here blessed. We go away here glorifying your name. And we go away here confident in the word and in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Everyone said amen.
Amen.
Give God one more praise. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you so much for those of you who drove from Portland. God bless you. Stay safe on your way home. Drive safely. God go with you. For all of you pastors in the house that have services tomorrow, we're praying with you that you will have a supernatural mighty move of God in your services tomorrow. If you don't have a place to be or an obligation to be somewhere, be right here. We start at 10 o'clock. We're going to bring it again. Pastor Scotty will close out the conference tomorrow morning right here at CLC. Come expecting. Don't be late. Don't be late. I know it's late right now, but don't be late. We'll see you tomorrow morning. God bless you. Hugs and bags. We'll see you tomorrow. Thank you.
I'll be here at 8. Probably 8:30, probably. Right.
Thank you.